child of God. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. Oh yes, I am. I am a child of God. 'Cause I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, let's proclaim this. 'Cause I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Sing it one more time. 'Cause I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Child of God. Caught up in your presence. Well, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in his holy moment. I never Jesus, you don't know me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. Oh, I'm sorry when I've just gone through. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. So take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Oh, I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. So take me back to where we started. I open my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. Sing this out. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Oh, Jesus, you don't know me anything, but more than anything that you can do, I just want you. Sing this out one more time. I'm caught up in your presence.
Mornings, but I never do. I don't know why. Sometimes I get up earlier. But I got up and it was kind of dark and, you know, and honestly, I was a little depressed. And everything that's happening and all the decisions that we have to make, do we this, do we do that, do we not do this? I felt like my brain was just going to pop a cork. And I sat at the kitchen table and I just was kind of praying and I just said, you know, God, I somehow need to hear from you. There's a lot of chatter going on and depending on which way you either tune in the news or all of the Facebook stuff, all of that. And there's so much chatter. I mean, you can go nuts with the chatter. This one's saying this, and this one's saying that, and this guy's saying something different, and Lord knows what that guy's saying, and you just start losing your mind. And the Lord said something very simple to me. He said, you have tuned in on everything but me. And that's why you have no peace today. There's an obscure verse in the Bible that says, he whose mind is stayed on you, he whose mind is stayed on you, walks in perfect peace. And I said, you know what? I'm going to take a minute and I'm just going to begin to worship God. And I'm going to redirect my focus to the one who has everything in his hand. And you know that the amazing thing is that when I did that, perfect peace started to flood through me. Oh, and get this. I didn't tell you this part. But we have a busted pipe under our house. And I was so stressed on how I'm going to fix that pipe that I had to actually go to the front room and cut a hole in the floor to get to it because it's so muddy that you can't go from the crawl hole space, right? And I was stressed out about that too. And God said, why don't you stop thinking about it and trust me? I got the saw that Kevin lent me, and I went to the front room and peeled back carpet. I thought, I don't know how to, I think it's there, but I'm not sure. I can hear it. And I cut a hole in that floor right above, most of you don't know what this is, but a shark bite coupling. One end of the shark bite had let go. A simple, simple fix. And I got done, and I said, I did this in like 15 minutes. And God said, see? What was all the stress? He whose mind has stayed on me walks in perfect peace. I've got even your plumbing. I've got it. Amen? Amen? You might be here today and you're kind of stressed out and wigged out. I would invite you that as we meet this morning that you would turn your attention, just divert your attention to him. And I promise you this, I promise you that when you will leave with perfect peace. Those of you that are watching at home, I would invite you to take your bedroom, your living room, wherever you're watching, your kitchen, I would invite you to make your house a sanctuary and experience the awesome presence of God right there where you're at. Amen? Amen. Amen. Well, We have had conversations with the sheriff's department this week, the sheriff's department has said you're good with what you're doing. We recommend that you wash your hands and sanitize your hands. So we have sanitizers by the hall, and we've got sanitizers going by all the doors. I don't know if they came in on Friday or not, but they'll be up this next week. And they said we'd recommend that you practice some safe distancing. So normally we do a meet and greet, but I'm going to invite you to do a meet and wave. How's that? We'll practice some stuff. Let's just take about a minute and just wave at some folks and say, God bless you. Well, it is a great honor for me today. We're going to graduate Shimon. Amen. Man, come on up here. This dude is awesome. Awesome. You brought us something to drink too?
Yeah.
You're all right, man. Sherry, come on up. This is Sherry. Anybody, come on up. Amen. Shimon has been 1 year his graduate. Woo! This Sunday.
Yeah!
And sometimes when folks graduate, they have plans, they move, they go back family or whatever. Some people opt and want to stay and give back. And so Shimon said to me, he said, Pastor, when I graduate, do I have to leave? And I said, no. He said, can I stay? I want to mentor other people and help City Church and their live-in center. So I,
Amen. All right. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to invite you to stretch your hand. We're going to pray and bless Shimon as he ventures out. We're trying to find employment, and God's going to open some doors for him, incredible doors, do some wonderful things. And God is going to use him to touch other people. Can I just say something? You don't even know what I'm going to say. You trust me that much. Okay. You correct me if I'm wrong. Shimon has spent most of his adult life in and out of prison. Am I right? And he told me, he said, Pastor, this is the first time in my life I've been clean and sober. You know, if God can do that for Shimon, God can do that for anybody here and anybody watching. God, give your life to Jesus and watch what he can do. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Father, we thank you for Shimon. What a blessing he is to us. I thank you for that, the fact that he's going to continue to be a blessing for us here in our city living center. Father, I pray that you place blessing upon him, upon his life, that your word says that the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Father, I pray that you will open up doors for him that no man could open, that you'll kick them open for him, and you'll make a way for him. Father, I pray that you'll bless him immensely, like never before in his life. We ask it in Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. All right.
We on the timer. Come on.
Come on.
We on the timer.
Shimon, this is not wine, is it? No. You check it.
This communion?
Excuse me. I've been having butter for a whole year. And I told somebody, only way I'm going to crack this open is I graduate. And I graduate. He ain't here. You know what I'm saying? But he gave me this bottle, so I'm cracking it because I graduated.
Yes. Thank you.
I need more.
This is the first.
So I'm going to make a toast. I'm going to make a toast to Jesus.
Yes.
And to Shimon.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Yes, yes sir.
Cheers, cheers. Right on, Shimon, man.
After a year, it tastes good.
Awesome. 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 Well, City Church, this is the first. I don't know that I've ever toasted Jesus in church, but amen.
While the world is sound asleep and too afraid of what might show up while you're dreaming. Nobody, nobody, nobody sees you. Nobody, nobody will believe you. And every day you try to pick up all the pieces, all the memories that somehow never leave you. Nobody, nobody, nobody sees you. Nobody, nobody will believe you. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. God only knows how it's killing you. But there's a kind of love that God only knows. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. But God only knows the real you. There's a kind of love that God only knows.
There's a kind of love that there's a kind of love.
You keep a cover over every single secret. So afraid if someone saw them they would leave. But somebody sees you. Somebody will never leave you. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. God only knows how it's killing you. But there's a kind of love that God only knows.
God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. But God only knows the real you. There's a kind of love that God only knows.
There's a kind of love that there's a kind of love. There's a kind of love that there's a kind of love.
For the lonely, for the ashamed, the misunderstood and the ones to blame. What if we could start over? We could start over. We could start over.
Oh, for the lonely, for the ashamed, the misunderstood and the ones to blame. What if we could start over? We could start over. We could start over. There's a kind of love that God only knows. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. But God only knows the real you. There's a kind of love that God only knows. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. But God only knows the real you. There's a kind of love that God only knows.
God only knows where to find you. God only knows how to break through. God only knows the real you. There's a kind of love that God only knows.
Well, we're going to jump right into Corinthians, 1 Corinthians. We're in chapter 6. We're starting chapter 6 today. I'm not sure how far we'll get this morning, if we'll make it through the entire chapter. The chapter is actually split into two basic subjects. But we're going to start at verse 1, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Verse 1, Paul is actually talking to the church. And he's addressing an issue that they have. Now, remember that as we go through this book of Corinthians, Paul is addressing one issue after another with the church. They've got some problems. But in chapter 6, Paul says, furthermore, how dare you take a fellow brother to court? So apparently there were people suing each other in church. How dare you take a fellow believer to court? It is wrong to drag him before the unrighteous to settle legal dispute. Isn't it better to take him before God, God's holy believers, to settle the matter? Don't you realize that we, the holy ones, that's you and I, we, the holy ones, will judge the universe? Some translation says that we will actually judge the angels. Did you realize that you have that kind of authority? That you actually, you and I, we will judge God's creation and we will judge the angelic host? You see, we tend to think that we're below everything, but God has elevated us to a place with Him, seated in heavenly places, to a place with Him, that you and I actually, before His presence, command more authority than the angelic host. That's why we will judge them at the end of time. That just blows my mind. I mean, that means I'm a somebody. I'm going to be able to judge God's creation. God has trusted me enough to judge his creation and all of the angels. I mean, wow. I mean, nobody's trusted me with that much before, but he trusts you and I with that much. He says, if the unbelieving world is under your jurisdiction, you should be fully competent to settle these trivial lawsuits among yourselves. For surely you know that we will one day judge angels, let alone these everyday matters. Don't you realize that you are bringing your issues before civil judges appointed by people who have no standing within the church? What a shame that there is not one within the church who has the spirit of wisdom who could arbitrate these disputes and reconcile the offended parties. It is not right for a believer to sue a fellow believer, and especially to bring it before unbelievers. So apparently there are folks that were suing each other in church. I've been to court a lot in my lifetime. In fact, at one point in my life, it seemed like I was in court every week settling some kind of matter. It was a business I was in. And I don't think that I've ever been sued but one time by another Christian. And I remember standing in court. I didn't sue them. They sued me. But I remember standing in court before the judge, and I remember that I felt ashamed. I felt embarrassed that I was being sued by this other individual who happened to be a pastor, which even added insult upon insult. And I remember standing in court thinking, I should not be here. This is, I hope nobody knows that I'm a Christian in this courtroom. I hope nobody knows that I go to City Church in this courtroom. I hope nobody knows that because I'm ashamed that I'm representing Jesus like this. Now, in this time that Paul is writing, remember, they're under Rome. They're under Rome's authority. So it is the Roman legal system, which was corrupt, much like our legal system today. If you know anything about our legal system, you'll know that it's not a matter of who has broken the law or who is right and who is wrong, but it is a matter of how you can use the law and manipulate it to get over on the other guy and thus be right, thus make you are right. You could have done the crime and still prove you're right in court because there is a way to manipulate the law. Our legal system did not start that way. In fact, there was a day before attorneys and before the legal system that we know today. There was a time in our history. Do you know who settled matters legally? It was pastors. They were called circuit pastors, and they went from town to town, and when two people had a dispute, they would... The pastor would take his Bible out, and he would invite them to put their hand on the Bible. And they would make a pledge before God, I solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. And then he would hear the matter, and he would make a decision as to who was right and who was wrong. And that's how legal matters were handled back in the beginning days of our nation. What happened was is that more and more immigrants started to come in that could not speak the language, and they would have somebody represent them before the pastor because they didn't know, they needed an interpreter. And from there, it grew and it grew and it grew till we had attorneys that did it full time. They did it as a profession, but get this, attorneys were not allowed to charge for their service. That's when the legal system wasn't corrupt. They could not charge for their service. And then there came a day that it became such an overwhelming industry that they were allowed to charge, but they could not advertise. Now, if you're 50 and over, you'll remember a day, I believe it was in the 70s, that the ban was lifted and attorneys could begin to advertise. There was a day that when you opened the Yellow Pages, you didn't see attorneys in there. There was a day that you didn't go down Highway 12 and see two attorneys on the billboard saying, "Let me represent you if you've been in a car accident." There was a day that they weren't on buses saying, "Let me handle your divorce or your bankruptcy or let me get you some money." There was a day they could not advertise. But then when that law was canceled out, now all you got to do is get a Yellow Page and you'll see that most of that book is filled with advertisements from attorneys. I don't know why I told you all that, just a little piece of history. Oh, we're talking about Roman legal system. It was corrupt then as it is today. Here's something about the Roman legal system. That remember last week we said that you could not sue somebody that had higher status than you. Do you remember that? Okay, you could not bring a lawsuit against somebody or bring them to court if they had a higher status than you. You just had to eat it. You were out of luck. But those that had a higher status, they could sue people with a lower status. So you could be sued by somebody that had higher status than you, but you couldn't sue them back. Within the Roman legal system, the juries were made up of folks with high status. In fact, you could not, in some colonies, you could not be a jury member unless you owned land. So everybody on the jury had a higher status. So if you were a poor person and you got dragged into court, your chances of winning were zero. Because the rich guy is being judged by his peers. And how many of you know they're not going to turn their back on one of their own? So as a poor person, you were out of luck. Now, it's believed that within the Corinthian church, that those that were of a higher status were taking advantage of that and suing people of lower status within the church, knowing that they would win and boast about their winning, which made them of an even higher status now that they were somebody in the church. It's interesting that Paul says to this church, he uses the word in verse 5, he said, it's almost as though he's speaking with a bit of irony. He's saying, you're going to court, and you guys are suing each other, but you don't realize that you are the church. And he uses the word there, and we looked at this probably a year ago in depth, but he uses the word ecclesia. You are the ecclesia, which was a Roman word. It was a Roman military word, because whenever Rome conquered an area, took control of an area, the Roman army would set up a station called the ecclesia. And the ecclesia was to impose Roman law on that area that they conquered. It was a governing body, much like our Senate today. It was a governing body. And Paul is using this word. He's saying, don't you realize that you are the ecclesia of your area? You are the church. You have authority. Your job is to judge and proclaim. Your job is to bind and loose. That's the authority that you have as the church of Jesus Christ. He has set up a command post right where you're at. You are his command post. And if you're going to judge the world and you're going to judge angels, how come there isn't somebody wise enough in your midst to judge your own stupid little matters with each other? He's clowning on them. It's irony the way that he is saying it to them. If you are the ecclesia, you should be able to judge a little dispute between two brothers. What's wrong with you guys? That you got to go to unbelievers that have nothing to do with God's kingdom, and you got to rely on them to pass a judgment? What's wrong with you guys? I was thinking about this word the other day, and I thought, it just hit me. We are God's command post for this area. We are God's command post. We're to take authority over this area. Remember, ecclesia is a Roman military word for command post. That's what Jesus has called us. Jesus was saying was that the gates of hell will not prevail, meaning you're attacking the realm of hell and the gates can't stand your attack. You're pushing them down and you're trampling all over hell. That's your and my job. Now, if Jesus said, this is how you pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, you have to ask yourself, what is the will of heaven? What is heaven's will? What is heaven's will for East Tabor? What is heaven's will for right where we're at? What's heaven's will? Somebody said to me some years back, this block was horrible. Man, I mean, it was horrible. I remember I'd drive here, and our neighbors over here in the little four-unit complex, they'd be out on the lawn with police with guns and being cuffed weekly. Number one meth dealer, Benny, lived right across the street. Ironically, he'd come to church sometimes. Lived right in that little house across the street. The Groves were off the hook, one of the worst complexes around. I remember shootings, without exaggeration, gunfire every week. You'd hear gun, boom, 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 right over our fence line. We come out of church some Sundays. We didn't know whether to get in the car, get behind the car. You know, just boom, 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 boom. And it's like, well, you shoot. Somebody's shooting. Where are they at? Gangs duking it out. I remember one guy, some guys are, went by in a car, grabbed a girl, dragged her right down Tabor Avenue, just dragged her alongside the car, just put her in the hospital. A guy came to me around the corner. He used to come to church once in a while. And he came, he said, I got to talk to you. He came to me. He said, Pastor, I live here. He said, do you realize what's happened since City Church has been here? Do you realize what's happened? And I said, no, I have no idea. What are you talking about? He said, there is no crime on our block. He said, crime only happens on that side of Dover and on the other side of Sunset. There is no crime on our block. The SWAT team used to suit up in our parking lot to raid apartments. When we had a preschool, the preschool thought it was like a movie. They'd all line up and they would watch them, just thought it was just the neatest thing in the world, watching the SWAT team suit up. And I started to think, I haven't seen SWAT here for months. Benny got thrown in prison. He's gone. There's nobody being arrested next door. And we went into the Groves and we established after school programs and things like that and started to bring food. We embraced the Groves and we threw big Christmas parties for the Groves here. And that apartment complex turned around and I said, I don't hear a siren on our block. You're right. And then that dawned on me, the kingdom of heaven. We brought the kingdom of heaven here. So, Let's just step back. Let's go back to what is the will of heaven? What is the will of heaven? Do you think that in heaven that there is that heaven's will is for people to live in poverty? Okay. Would heaven's will be for people to live in homelessness? Is heaven's will for people to live in addiction? So if we're to bring heaven's will to earth where we're at, then our job is to attack everything that doesn't belong in heaven is to attack it in the name of Jesus and send it right back to hell where it belongs, but not on our block, not in our area, not in our town. So let's just... Friday, gang got into it over here on Dover, right? Not on our side, I'm just saying. 8 gunshots, 1 guy put in the hospital with almost fatal hit in the head. The other guy, it wasn't that serious, but he went to the hospital. And I started to think, we're not thinking big enough as a church. You know, we claim Tabor Avenue. We claim this block. We didn't claim that block. And somebody might be dead this morning because we haven't claimed that block. You know what, church? We need to claim that block and the block on the other side of Sunset and the block all the way to Texas and the block that way all the way to whatever that street that runs out to Walmart is. We need to broaden our authority and to take authority over it and to stop that stuff in Jesus' name, because we're the governing body. We have authority to tell the devil, go back to your home and stay in hell where you belong. You do not belong here in our yard. let me just throw something else at you real quick. I told everybody we're not talking about the virus. But can I just say something without being political? I'm just going to say something. You just marinate on this for a minute. You can throw it out if you want or keep it if you want. I thought, why can't we, in the name of Jesus, as his ecclesia, proclaim there is no virus on Tabor Avenue? Why can't we be the one block in Fairfield where nobody gets sick? I'm just saying, if we're the ecclesia, we're the governing body, we have all authority given to us by Jesus Christ, and I don't think the coronavirus is in heaven. I don't think it's heaven's will for there to be a corona anything. So why can't we take authority? Now, I'm not saying go out and be stupid and lick doorknobs and toilet seats. And I'm not saying that. Don't read into what I'm saying. We do have common sense. But what I am saying is, why can't we, as the ecclesia, take authority over something? Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I don't think God's willing it in heaven. Why can't we take authority as God's people and put a stop to this thing? Now, I may not have enough faith to put a stop over it for the nation, but there are enough churches around the nation that if every church would claim their area, we could put a stop. So I'm going to start by claiming Tabor Avenue. That's where I have enough faith for Tabor Avenue. And I'm going to pray that God increases my faith for Fairfield and maybe enough to cover Solano. But right now, I have enough faith for Tabor Avenue, and I'm praying, God, no virus on Tabor Avenue. Whether people are saved or not makes no difference. They can thank me later for my faith. Because when this thing is all gone, I think we can go door to door and say, are you healthy? They're going to go, yep. Have you been healthy? They're going to go, yep. You can say, you can thank us. We kept you healthy. You can just thank us later. Come to church on Sunday. God bless you. Amen. Goodbye. Okay. Let's jump into verse 7. Verse 7 says, don't you realize that when you drag another believer into court, you're providing the evidence that you are already defeated? I mean, that's kind of strong. You're already defeated. You just shot yourself in the foot. Wouldn't it be better to accept the fact that someone is trying to cheat and take advantage of you and simply choose the higher road? At times, it would be better to just accept injustice and even to let someone take advantage of you rather than expose our conflicts publicly before unbelievers, but instead you keep cheating and doing wrong to your brothers and sisters, and then you request that unbelievers render their judgment. That's a mouthful, isn't it? So what is Paul saying? Why would he say you're already defeated? I was thinking, somebody said something in one of our devotions about the supernatural. And the comment was how we don't see the supernatural like we saw in the Bible in Jesus' day, where people are getting healed and raising from the dead and stuff like that. And I had an answer for it, but it wasn't a really good one. But I started thinking, yeah, you're kind of right. But then as I thought about it, I thought, you know what, we see the supernatural. We see the supernatural right here, right now. And let me tell you what it is. Jesus said that there's only one way that people know you're my disciple. Only one. Did you know that? We think it's maybe the way we speak, the way we dress, whether we go preach to our neighbor. That proves that you're his disciple. Jesus didn't say that. He said there's only one way that people will know you're my disciple, if you have love for one another. That's the only way. So, and here's the supernatural part of it. Here's why it is a testimony that we're disciples of Jesus. Here's why there's a testimony. Because you can take people with different backgrounds. Do you know, we're such a diverse group here, it's scary. We have so many different backgrounds. We have white-collar folk and we have penitentiary folk. All sitting, well, not necessarily next to each other because we're doing social distancing, but sitting close enough to see each other and wave, okay? Where else would two groups like that come together and actually like each other? So we have people with high income. We have folks with no income can sit together and like each other and respect each other. We have Democrats here, and we have Republicans here. But we're not out burning each other's cars up in the parking lot, are we? We can have diverse political views and be okay with it. I don't have to fight you because you don't agree with me politically. I can respect you and love you for what you believe, even if you are wrong. It's okay. We have people with different zip codes. You might be living on the other side of the 80 freeway by the golf course, and you have that zip code, but you may be living somewhere in Fairfield that you have bars on your window. You have that zip code, but that's okay. What about the color of skin? What about the color of skin? Prison yards, people that are locked up, segregate. Don't kid yourself. We think that segregation and everything is done, and to a degree, but if you drive neighborhoods, you'll still see segregation today. I can take you to supermarkets where I can go in and guarantee you that it's predominantly white people that shop there. I can take you to some other supermarkets that I can say it's predominantly black people that shop there. I can take you to a supermarket where I can guarantee it's almost 99.9% Hispanic shopping there. So we say there's no segregation, but in all reality, there kind of is. Except in God's house. How cool is that? And we love cultures that are not us. We respect cultures that are not us. We learn from cultures that are not us. It is super, super cool. I mean, I love the fact that I'm in a multicultural church. I dig it. You guys are my folks. This is family to me. I feel at home. I can even make fun of the way some of you dress, and it's okay. Because you don't have to dress like me. It is all good. You can't have that anywhere else. You can't have that anywhere else. The only place you'll find that is in God's house. That alone is a testimony to the world that we're his disciple. Because, man, I can give you a hug. I can be genuine about it. I can love you. I can help you. I can go to bat for you. And you and I don't look alike. We don't come from the same part of the world or the same part of the United States. And yet we become one. We become brethren. We're God's people. We're God's children. And that trumps everything else. I'm sorry. That comes first. I love you because you're God's child. He loves you. And he puts a love in my heart for you. And then you love back. And man, we just have a great time. That's the only way the world knows that we're disciples. You can do all kinds of things and think that you're being a testimony to the world. But I'm going to challenge that. And I'm going to say that is the only way the world knows that we're disciples. And yet, we wonder why the world doesn't get saved. We wonder why people aren't flocking to Jesus Christ. It's because churches are fighting each other. They're stealing people from each other. They're talking smack about each other. Pastor's clowning on that pastor, and that deacon's clowning on those deacons. And we wonder why the world just stands back and goes, I ain't buying it. That Jesus thing just is not real. Because if we can't love each other, it's fake. Churches that have no love, they are fake. Ministries that have no love, they are fake. You know what I love about City Church? I was sharing with somebody, and it's not just because I come here. This is what I love. This is sometimes I just stand back and I don't get involved and I just sit back and I just watch. Let's just take our strike force on Sunday. Our bus goes out to homeless encampments, and we bring back folk. We give them showers. We give them a haircut. Do you know that some of those people that get haircuts, do you know that they shed a tear every now and then? Because it's the first time in a long time they felt good about themselves. We give them a change of clothes. We give them a meal. I think the other week we gave them a meal, and we gave them a meal to take with them. Okay. Forget what I was talking about. Oh, this is what I love about City Church. I step back and I watch it and I just think, how cool is that? I'm not capping on any other group, but not many churches would embrace that culture. Not many churches would get down and dirty and embrace that kind of ministry. But I think, how could you not? How could you not? There's a whole population here in need. If you're bringing heaven to earth, people at homeless encampments deserve a piece of heaven? It's our job to give it to them. And you know what the cool thing is? That's not even my deal. I didn't think it up. And I ain't the guy directing traffic. There's a team with Rob. There's a team. You guys are doing it. I just sit back and watch in absolute amazement and think, I am so glad I am here. I'm so glad I'm doing exactly what the Bible talks about. I'm just not preaching it and expecting other people to do it. I'm glad we get the opportunity to do it. You know, we could talk about healing all day long and Jesus healing people, but not too many people talk about Jesus touching a leper. Most contagious disease of his time. You contracted it with a touch. Lepers would come, nobody touched them. In fact, the law said that if you're a leper, when you came down the street, you had to yell out, I'm a leper, I'm a leper, to give people the chance to get off the sidewalk and get away from you. They came to Jesus. At one point, 10 of them came to Jesus because they had no one. Their family couldn't be with them. Kids couldn't be with them. Their wife, the husband couldn't be with them. All they had was each other because they were already contaminated. They came to Jesus, and I'm sure they had social distancing. Jesus, just say that I'm healed. You don't have to come any closer because I'm very contagious. And he walked right up and touched them. Touched their leprosy. That is a level of love that blows my mind. So not to brag about 3 o'clock and what we do, but that's the kind of love we are having on a population at risk. And why did they cry? Because nobody else is. And nobody else does. So I don't know about you, but I am really proud of City Church. I wear a city. I wear my City Church coat with pride. When I go to the supermarket, I go, uh-huh, that's right, you see it, buddy. We're the ecclesia of Fairfield. Don't mess with me. Because we are bringing the kingdom of heaven wherever we go. We're proclaiming God's kingdom. And we're sending the devil back to hell. You know what? I'm out of time. But I'm going to go over time and say this one thing. You know the old joke about preaching is we always say in closing and then we take another 30 minutes.
That's okay.
Do you know the answer to homelessness in Fairfield? It's the church. The government can't do it. The city can't do it. The police can't do it. It's God's people that have the answer. We need to pray that other churches start stepping up. Because if we all stepped up, we'd eradicate homelessness in Fairfield. If all the churches stepped up. Amen. Amen. I was thinking as they were passing the juice and the crackers, I was thinking, we have all of this authority as the church. Because of what he gave up to give it to us. We have an awesome responsibility. Do you realize that? We have a responsibility to represent the kingdom of heaven. And what Jesus sacrificed to give that to us, to entrust us with it. I don't know about you, but I take that pretty seriously. I don't want to stand before him and him ask, did you represent me? Did you represent heaven well? I paid with my life for you to do it. And then I say, no, we didn't. Man, I want to I want to get to heaven and say, well, now that you've asked, you got about 3 hours. I'd like to run down everything we've done for the kingdom of heaven to promote Jesus Christ in Fairfield. Amen. All right. Jesus, we thank you that your body was broken for us and for your... this bread this morning, we do not do so without realizing the price that you paid to entrust us with the authority to represent you and to represent heaven well. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. And the Bible said that he spilt his blood so that we could be made whole. It's amazing. You have a right to be made whole. Did you know that? You have a right because it was paid for you already. You have a right to it. If you're here today and you're not whole, you need to claim it. You need to claim your right. It's your God-given right to walk in wholeness because he paid the price for it. Father, we thank you for your blood that was shed for us to bring us in right standing with you, to make us whole, to bring us into absolute, total forgiveness. We thank you for that. And as we take this cup, we do so in remembrance of you and what you've done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now you're sad and blue. There's always someone who has it worse than you. Sometimes you gotta pay your dues. So don't worry, just push on through.
Keeping it real.
Gotta dig up all my peoples who be working on the future, though they know they gotta struggle.
Keeping it real.
So all my peoples working on the 9-to-5 and doing right to keep themselves up out of trouble.
Keeping it real.
Although sometimes I know it seems impossible, there ain't no need in drowning in your sorrow.
Keeping it real.
If things are as bad as they can be, you could be sure there'll be a brighter tomorrow.
Keeping it real.